let's enjoy further the texture simulations and then see some examples of the power of modeling. So this time we will look into the texture related effects in torsion, in torsion deformation, which can be done on bars, solid bars, also on tubes. When it is done on a solid bar, a little bit more complex because the shear strain is zero in the middle and maximum on the surface. So there is a strain gradient in it. And for tubes, tube deformation, usually large strains cannot be achieved unless you put a mandrel inside the tube so that strain localizations are avoided. There are axial effects and torsion texture evolution. Torsion is a simple shear in terms of deformation mechanism. Unless we let the sample lengthen or shorten, then it is just shear. So we look into some peculiarities of texture formation in shear deformation for torsion, the axial effects, and then also how it is possible, for example, to introduce dynamic recrystallization into the modeling and then see how the effects actually can be reproduced and then identified with the help of modeling. So what kind of textures can be obtained in torsion? So when we deform a bar and the length is fixed, then actually at every point within the bar there is a simple shear state. So the shear plane, macroscopic shear plane, is parallel to the end of the specimen, and the shear direction is in the rotation direction. This is the macroscopic state, of course. So that is simple shear deformation. Yeah, we already discussed quite extensively. If there is length change, then we should be able to model it. It should be obtained, the length change, instead of imposing it on the sample. And this is also possible. Now, we did also mechanics analysis with Professor Stüwe in the year of 2000. Perhaps you know about the consider criterion, which is for tensile deformation. So we extended it for other deformation modes, especially when length changes is happening in the deformation of torsion. So we wrote the hardening part. If the hardening, rate of hardening of the material is sufficiently large, there is no strain localization. We take into account the Taylor factor variations and the length changes in this analysis. That is just for a note. We are not going into the details. The main point actually is what kind of textures we can have. I show you a texture evolution at room temperature here, starting from shear strain of 2, and then we are in ODF space. Only one section of the ODF is shown here. This is the 0 degree section at 2 strains, 2 and 5.5. You see, this is already a very large strain in terms of strain measure, but one can readily go to 5 or even 10 or 20 shear strain in torsion. So here we only look at the 0 degree section. You see here the shear strain is 11. So really the deformation of the material is so large, I can indicate it to you by a simple diagram how much is the deformation, how much we deform the material when we are at strain of 11. Yeah. We just take the initial material element in this dimension. Yeah. The shearing is making it shear in that direction. So we just have to go 11 times of this distance here, which is somewhere here, right. That stream is here, and then connect these. So this is the shear deformation we applied. Initial shape of a material element and the shape after. You see plenty of, actually, grains are supposed to be aligned morphologically like this. Of course, in the microstructure, you will not see that. The microstructure will be subdivided, and many small grains will be seen by grain fragmentation. And this is the texture which belongs to that state of deformation. What can we see? Three. This is just one section, but of course one can plot all of them. But here one can see a kind of evolution. There are three major ideal spots. They are called A1, C, and A2, or A1 star, C, and A2 star. Ideal orientations, they are supposed to be here, here, and here. There is an additional component, which is the so-called rotated cube. If there is initially cube orientation, then it will actually appearing and then also rotating. What is happening in shear deformation, because there is a rigid body rotation here, that it will always be present, and somehow it is drifting orientations all the time. But there are ideal orientations, you see, these ones. The most relevant one is perhaps this one here, and then that one, and that one. But increasing the strain, here 5.5, you see that this is going down very much in intensity, and then the C component becomes very strong, right? Further increasing the strain, C component increases, this practically disappears, and that component comes back again, so it is increasing. So we see that kind of drifting of the mass of population of grains from the right to the left. This is here the phi1 angle from 0 to 180 degrees. Because for shear textures, there is a twofold symmetry of the process. So the first Euler angle sufficient go up to 180 degrees. The second Euler angle here goes to 90. And the third one is from 0 to also 90, but you only look at 0 degree. And actually, when torsion is done in the positive direction, then we can find out, we can put on this figure what would be the rotation which belongs to the rigid body rotation. So the sample reference system is like this, axis 1, axis 2, and here is our material that we deform, we shear in the positive direction. Okay? Like this. Now, if there was a crystal here, and it has an orientation, then the first Euler angle would be a rotation angle, positive, with respect to axis 1. You know the definitions of the Euler angles now already. First, we make the two reference systems, the crystal reference system and the sample reference system, coincided. And then rotate first around axis 3 by an angle of phi1 angle, right? And then there will be rotation around this new axis, and finally around the new 3 axis. I'm only looking at the first rotation here first, because this rotation is making the phi1 angle, the rigid body rotation which is imposed is like this. So rigid body rotation. Okay? That is the first Euler angle. The rigid body rotation is trying to rotate everything to the right, which means that the phi 1 angle should be decreasing, right? If the crystal is following the rigid body rotation, then this axis, which is the phi 1 new one axis of the crystal, should be decreasing. So the rigid body rotation in this figure appears like that, from the right to the left. We can put it as a vector in this reference system. That means that orientations are drifted naturally by the rigid body rotation to the left. So, and indeed, this intensity here first will decrease, meaning that in that orientations from here are going that way and supplying the increase of the population of grains here. And then also from here grains are leaving to the second one, increasing the intensity there. So there is a shift from the right to the left, and the shift agrees with the direction of the rigid body rotation. Simple shear is very particular because of this rigid body rotation present. At the same time, when we look at the length of the sample, we observe that there are length changes. This curve here, which is the shear strain, and here is the length change in percentage, shows that at room temperature, copper can lengthen during torsion up to about 5% at a shear strain of 11. There are two stages. This is a lengthening, and then the rate of lengthening is decreasing. When we increase the temperature, 125 degree, this is temperature here, 200 or 300, then this is changing. The length change is less, and it can even go into a saturation and go into a shortening. From here, arriving to this length of the sample, it will further shorten. So these are phenomena which need explanation, and why it is happening in the material. Why at higher temperature the finally shortening can be observed. So with these we see a couple of effects. The texture variations, the axial length changes, and also asymmetry of the ideal orientations with respect to ideal positions. We go back and try to see it. For example, the C component should be exactly in the middle here, but it is not there. It is like not reaching yet the ideal position. It's also the same for all these orientations which are ideal. They are in off position more than 5 degrees, even at the strain of 2. And finally, here the C component arrives into the symmetric position. So the orientations do not appear exactly in the ideal positions. They are in tilted position. All these effects are quite interesting. And for a long time, there was no appropriate explanation for that in shear textures. But shear texture is very important. And then we will see what we can do in terms of explanation. The rigid body rotation is extremely important in shear. And here I recall our crystal plasticity lattice rotation equation, what we established already. The lattice spin, so the orientation change of the crystal, is the difference between the so-called rigid body spin. Rigid body spin is the shear what we apply, and the plastic spin, which is realized made by the slip system activity. So this is macroscopic. This is imposed by the test. And this is made by the crystals because they have slip systems which are active. So they produce the plastic spin, another rotation. And if the two rotations are different, then there is no lattice spin. The crystal stays in position in spite of the large strain. But if they are not equal, and this is constant, quite a large value, then the crystal has to rotate. This is usually larger than that one, or this can be positive or negative, and then the difference is varying. Certain orientations rotate, others they do not. But it's very important to understand that this component here, for example, in tensile or compression strain, is zero. It's just not there. And then the lattice spin would be just the rotation opposite to the plastic spin. Well, this is quite large here, and it will make very interesting effects on the texture evolution and slip system selection and slip system activity. Namely, for a stable orientation, so here, so that it becomes zero. For stable orientation, the lattice spin has to be very small. The crystal doesn't rotate. So if it is zero, then we can have a zero only if omega dot is equal to beta dot. So lattice spin has to be, the plastic spin has to be large, not small, to get orientation stability. While in a tensile test or compression or rolling and all these axial deformations which do not involve shear deformation, this is not here, and simply the plastic spin has to be very small to get stability. So the crystal has to make either very large plastic spin or very small plastic spin, depending on what deformation mode is applied on the crystal, if you are doing compression, rolling, or if you are doing shear. Shear requires very large plastic spin. Now, very large plastic spin, if you want to make it, can be made if only just a few slip systems are active. Ideally, only one. If there is only one slip system active, then we have the maximum plastic spin possible. If there are many slip systems activating at the same time, then the resultant plastic spin can approach the zero, because these plastic spin vectors corresponding to each slip system cancel, more or less cancel each other. Actually, let me show you what will be the how we have to understand the plastic spin. It is very simple to represent it. I show here a slip plane. Okay, so this is a slip plane of a crystal which is active. Okay, so here is the slip direction, and here is the normal direction, N and B, and it's active. When we calculate the velocity gradient, we did already, we obtained the equation for that, and when we take the antisymmetric part of it, we found out that the rotation vector corresponding to the antisymmetric part is a vector which is like this, perpendicular to N and B. Perpendicular, it's right here. That's the omega dot plastic spin vector. It is in the plane and perpendicular to N and B. So obviously, if there is only one slip system active, then our plastic spin cannot be zero. Yep, because it's exactly this vector, and rotating with a certain speed. Exactly this cannot be zero, because the slip system is active. If we have different slip systems, like, you know, this one, that one, that one, each of them is producing some kind of plastic spin, and for several slip systems, these vectors can cancel each other. So all together, they can make a small vector. But here, for the shear deformation, we need large omega dot. Because this is large, it has to be compensated. Compensation will be done only with one or two slip systems. So it can be shown precisely analytically what, how many slip systems should be active in the ideal positions of shear textures, only one or two slip systems. For example, in the here what we look at, the C orientation is deforming with two slip systems, and each they are equal slip. This is one and more or less one and a half, also two, and this is also two. Here we don't see example that there's only one. Only one orientation is deforming with single slip. This is the so-called A orientation. The A orientation in a simple shear is such that the shear plane is parallel to the applied shear. And then the shear direction is also in that direction. So it can perfectly compensate the rigid body rotation. The situation is such I show here. So that's our usual simple shear. And here is the slip system, parallel. So it is slipping in this way, in that direction precisely. Slip system is like that. So this is a here a 111 direction, and here this is a 110 direction in FCC, simply shear. Well, obviously here we can see that the relation, which is omega dot equal to beta dot minus the other omega dot, that was equation, yes, for the plastic spin is oriented like that, yeah, okay, and then the plastic spin is oriented in that direction, the rigid body spin is oriented in this direction, so this is a rotation like that, and the other is a rotation like this, so the two cancel each other, and then omega dot becomes zero. This orientation remains stable and expected to produce a large intensity in the ODF, the single slip orientation. But all ideal orientations of shear textures, they deform only one or two slip systems. That's very different from rolling, for example, where you need at least four slip systems active. Four, minimum, to get zero plastic spin. We understand it because in rolling there is no beta dot, so we have to make a zero plastic spin vector. We need the simultaneous activation of several slip systems to produce zero plastic spin, so zero lattice spin. Slip activity. Now we are looking also in orientation space. In orientation space. So, and we define, we examine not the slip activity. But we have this constitutive law, which permits to have several slip systems active at the same time. And because of the law, in principle, all of them are active, but with very different activities. Some of them are completely negligible. So we can define how many slip systems are really active. I'm using this definition to calculate what are the number of operating slip systems. This is the summation of all the slips divided by the maximal value of the slip. There is one always, which is the maximum slip rate, and we normalize it with that and make the summation. So if there is only one slip system active, then this is one, for two it is two, and so on and so forth. if there are 12 active, but with very small gamma dot s, it will give, of course, not an integer number, but it gives an appropriate number to represent how many slip systems are active. So this calculation easily done when in the code we resolved the strain equation. Then we know how many slip systems, what are the slips. We know the n active. And here in this map, I show these values as a function of orientation for simple shear. That's a map of number of active slip systems in FCC simple shear in ILS space in the phi 2 equal 45 degree section. This section contains most of the ideal orientations. Here you can find the A, B, and C component. This is the famous single slip. B and C, C is two slips. And the B bar, A2 star, B and A1 star, and then the A bar, B bar, and C components. There are also not only single ideal components, which is a general thing. There are fibers. Fibers in deformation textures, there are never just single ideal orientations. Let me make some comment on that. You know ODF space. This is just one section, but ODF space, yeah, orientation space is for phi 1, phi, and then phi 2. Okay? So when material deforms and then the ODF is made, orientation distribution can be traced. There are always, for deformation, fibers. So somewhere it starts. It never ends, actually. Fibers which are made, ideal orientations on fibers they are something like this. They are not ending ever in orientation space. Ideal orientations can be on them. There are different fibers if they. There is two. They always cross each other somewhere. So there is no such a case that here is an ideal orientation and nothing else, or just a segment here in ODF space, and then outside here and there, no stability. Doesn't exist. In my experience, all my simulations and also experimental observations, they say that deformation textures are always fibers and they are continuous. The intensity distribution can be such that you might think that there is a gap here, but the ideal position is still there. This situation looks like dislocations in the crystal. Do you know that dislocations are also such that they are ending, for example, on a particle, or they are ending at the grain boundary, and they can be also joined, and then different Burgers vectors. But there is no such a state that a dislocation is ending within the crystal inside. That's not possible. Interestingly, it's the same for the textures made by deformation. This is something which I always saw, And I believe it is true in general, but never anybody was able to show it analytically. So I'm asking you in your future texture studies, please show somehow, make a proof that it must be like this. Something to do in the future. I couldn't do that. So here in the shear textures, there is one fiber here, A, B, and C. All these orientations here, which are in between, they are possible ideal positions. And the other fiber is not visible. The other fiber is crossing here. It's going like that at the A position. For the slip system activity, as I said, the ideal orientations, they only have one or two. So the eyes of values here, they represent the number of active slip systems. You see, it is two for the C orientation exactly. It's two. And then as we approach the A orientation, here we find in the center 1.2. It's not exactly, this is 1.2 here, but one has to be here in the A. The B orientation is something like 1.4, 1.5. And this is also a very low value. All ideal orientations have very low number of active slip systems. But those orientations which are not ideal, they rotate. And they have a number of slip systems very high. Here, at this corner, one can find the cube orientation. Cube orientation in simple shear is rotating very fast. It is rotating together with the rigid body spin. For the cube orientation, but only in shear. For the cube, so this is the relation. For the cube orientation. What happens? That for the cube, omega dot is zero. Precisely zero. Because of symmetries and because of so many slip systems active. One can see that it's eight here. Eight slip systems are active for a shear of cube. And so that makes a zero plastic spin. Consequently, the cube orientation must rotate exactly with the rigid body spin. And it does. It's not only here, but it's also here. For a positive shear, it is going to move on that line in this direction. Actually, the position how it moves, the function of strain, it exactly agrees with the expected rigid body rotation and can be a measure of strain. We always see the cube component rotating during plastic shear. And of course, it is a general flow trend is the rigid body rotation direction in this figure. Another interesting feature of shear textures, and let me show you this here. I'm going, where is it? I need another figure. I need another figure here. I saw it. No, I don't find. Anyway, you already got the message, I believe, that crystal orientations must rotate in that way. If this is not zero here. And as they approach ideal orientations, they slow down and they might stay there. So I will make now a sketch because I don't find my figure. Let's take the C orientation, which is here. In the vicinity of the C orientation, so this is direction phi 1 angle, and this is phi. here, exactly at that point, the lattice rotation value is very, very small. Actually, not exactly zero, but extremely small. It cannot be zero because, finally, strain rate sensitive slip leads to a situation when the plastic, the lattice rotation finally is not exactly zero, but very small value. And orientations which are far, they are rotating in this direction. Okay? They are approaching, in orientation space, the ideal position. They also slow down, so the rotation is displacement in orientation space is decreasing. And when they arrive here, it becomes very, very small. Of course, they can also, those who are here, they might go and do not reach the C orientation. There's a certain catchment area before the C, which is going to collect all orientations inside. But behind the C orientation, the flow is similar. Like this, small vectors going out, and becoming larger and larger, you see? So if an orientation manages to cross to the other side, this is the border, gets to the other side of the border, then instead of staying with the C orientation, it will escape and accelerate, crossing the border and escaping rapidly into the inside of the other country. Yes?
So these are plastic spin
vector? This is the lattice spin vector. It's not it's a small omega dot. Small omega dot vectors. The plastic spin is another vector. So here I am plotting this omega equal beta dot minus omega dot. And this is the plastic spin, slip activity, rigid body spin, and the resulting omega dot. And this is what is making the grains really rotate. So we are looking in orientation space, and we see that in simple shear, in shear deformation, orientations are coming from one side. They're approaching only from one side. They are not approaching from the other side. Obviously, such situation leads to an accumulation of orientations as deformation begins somewhere here, on one side. And then it looks like the ideal orientation is not in the right place. But it evolves. If you continue the strain, then the intensity goes to the symmetrical position. And then after it can even go away. Because if grains are in this other section, then they will accelerate and leave. In asymmetric situation, in simple shear. And this is very spectacular and very different from other deformation modes. Rolling. If we take a rolling ideal component, okay, this is a rolling, I don't know which one, whatever we take for all of them is the same situation. Ideal position in Euler space, orientation space. Grains are coming everywhere. They are not leaving. They are just coming in. So this is why it's a very different situation. Here, on one side, they are coming, other side, they are leaving. The consequence are several effects. One, that the orientations are accumulating first on one side. And the other is that they are able to finally disappear and go into another component. Because here there is an ideal, then they can move across slowly, but it takes time. And then once they are here, they will rotate into another component. So these texture transitions in simple shear are readily possible. While in rolling, that's completely different situation in terms of lattice rotation space. Also, here in this position, we only have one or two slip systems. Here, we need minimum more than or equal to 4, because there is no rigid rotation, and then the omega dot has to be small, which requires more slip systems. So all the ideal orientations of rolling textures, they have at least 4 slip systems. And all other orientations of simple shear textures have only 1 or 2. It can go up to 8 in the rolling case. This can be shown actually analytically, theoretically, this interesting difference of the shear textures with respect to other kind of textures. Actually, this is the divergence quantity which can be defined. Here you see there is convergence, there is divergence. Now, there is a mathematical quantity which is defined for this to study. This is the divergence of the rotation field. G dot is actually calculated. G dot is a vector which is defined as phi 1 dot, phi dot, and phi 2 dot. So basically, these are G dot vectors here. Okay? And there is a gradient in them because they converge. And the gradient is here, gradient in direction phi 1, in direction phi 2, and phi and phi 2. The sum of these three gradients define the so-called divergent quantity. It's a scalar quantity. When there is convergence of the orientations, then divergent G dot is negative. We obtain this value as negative. When there is a divergence, then the div G dot is positive. So in simple shear, this divergence quantity, which I also show here, is changing exactly in the ideal position. Here it is negative, here it is positive. So you see I plotted here the borders of the divergent quantity. These are the dotted lines here, the borders. They cross the ideal orientations. So on one side, it is divergent, here it's convergent, divergent, convergent, and so on. And the ideal orientation is exactly in the middle. While here, for rolling, the divergent quantity is always negative, all around the ideal orientation. Another very interesting mathematical difference between the two kinds of deformation modes. Actually, it is also possible to look at the orientation changes or texture evolution completely differently, because we have this G dot, velocity field in orientation space, and that is like material flow, but it's orientation flow, which is compressible. It doesn't keep the it is compressible flow. It's like fluid motion, and we can use elements of fluid mechanics to construct the evolution of our ODF intensity. ODF intensity here is written in an equation. It's the F. F is the intensity of the texture. So F, as a given G orientation, is the ODF intensity. Its intensity at a given point can be written in an equation in which we have the gradient is a function of strain. A gradient is a function of intensity variation, so location. We have G dot here, we have the divergent quantity. And we have a correction factor here, which is because orientation space is varying volume, unit volume. So this is just the distortion of Euler space. It requires the cotangent phi quantity here. This is a differential equation, which is kind of fluid motion equation. It can be also used, if one can is able to solve it, to predict the evolution of the ODF. This is a little bit tricky. You have to know G dot vectors as a function of position. Basically, that's it. If you know this, then all these quantities can be calculated. You must have an initial F, initial distribution of the ODF. And this equation solved will give you the evolution of the ODF during strain. Once we did that for special fibers, and we were able to solve this equation and to show how the ODF should theoretically vary as a function of strain. It also explains this equation, why this texture transition is happening. Actually, it's reproducing this texture transition that, for example, the A2 star orientation rotates into the C, that can rotate into the A1 and then A2 and so on. And in simple shear, this kind of periodicity of the texture can usually appears. But I have to repeat, it requires large strains. You have to have at least shear strain of 5 or 10 to see that it is happening. But now, these days, there are simple shear experiments to extremely large strains, like the ECAP, well, this is up to shear strain of 2. But you can do HPT. You can deform the copper as a disc in high pressure torsion. And then you can go to extremely large shear strains. And then all these effects are happening and can be more easily visible. But what is also happening is grain fragmentation. And then things become a little bit more complicated. Now, in all these effects, there is a detectable effect of the strain rate sensitive value M, what we use for our crystal plasticity simulations. First of all, if we increase the M value, we will have more activity of the slip systems. We will reduce the lattice spin so that when M is equal to 1, the lattice spin becomes 0. And also it's responsible for the textual transitions because non-zero strain rate sensitivity actually produces non-zero lattice rotation in the ideal positions. Small values are possible, but they are not perfectly zero. So orientations slowly can cross these ideal positions. Some simulations reproduce some of these effects. On pole figures, this is a very early work. So here, at that time, the subconsistent model was not existing. So I used the Taylor model, but already the Taylor model was able to show that the textures are asymmetric in torsion. This is the direction of shear. Shear plane is like this. And we can see shear strain of 1 that the position of the high intensity is tilted. The whole texture is tilted with respect to the symmetry of the test. And that very large strain, and here is 12, then finally it is switches to the other side. So one can detect how the tilts are appearing. It is the effect of the rotation field and together combined with the effect of strain rate sensitivity. So then later came the self-consistent model, and then we used that one. I show some of the results. Here, this is the shear strain of 2, and this is a shear strain of 5.5. We see that there is a considerable evolution here. That's the measured texture, and this is the simulated one. And quite reasonable agreement can be obtained. Like, this is obviously a very strong component initially, and becomes almost negligible in the experiment, and practically disappears in the simulation as well. The self-consistent model was able to give more explanations and better modeling. Let's see now the axial effect evolution in simple shear. As I showed, this is the experiment up to shear strain of 11 at room temperature. If you look at also aluminium and copper at the same time, at higher temperatures, no, this is also room temperature. And here this is the strain. That's another experiment for aluminium and copper. It looks to be similar, so first increasing and then decreasing. It was published in 1985. And I would like to mention an interesting experiment, which was done on low carbon steel sample. This experiment was done at McGill University by Francisco Borrato, and he came to see me. I was at the time there, 30 years ago, and then he showed me this sample, and he said, "Laszlo, I lost the control of my torsion machine, and then it was twisted very, very much, and now the sample is twice shorter." So he twisted at elevated 1,000 degree temperature, actually. So it's in the austenite state, FCC. And it is red because of oxidation. The picture was taken later. But it was initially 22 millimeter high, and after the experiment, it is only 11 millimeter. So shortened a lot, and it became, of course, like a barrel, because it's like a compression, but it was real shortening, not compression. Torsion was applied on the specimen, the length, and then decreased, so much that it went out of the grip. And then Francisco, he took it out and then showed me, because he knew that I was working on this lengthening and shortening effects. Here you are, 50% shortening of the sample during, he couldn't tell me the strain because he lost the control of the machine. That's why it happened. So shortening can also happen, not only lengthening. Other examples. This is axial stresses. Now let me go to here. Yes. This is experiment here. It's again on copper. A copper alloy, which was in the form of wire, kind of wire, and then it was twisted, quite shear strains. In the as-received state, the wires were shortening. And then when they were annealed 150 degrees C, still shortening, 200 degrees C, less shortening. But when we annealed them, and after we did the torsion at room temperature, these are the annealing temperatures, then we got lengthening on the same material. So what happened between 200 degrees C and 250? Actually, there was recrystallization in the material. Another texture developed, and then it turns out that the axial effect, what we can see here, depends on what texture is in the material. the initial texture is such, then the sample will shorten. If it is another, then it might lengthen. Exactly the same material, just the texture is different. So we were able to reproduce these by simulation because 111 type of textures were initially in the material, but the heat treatment was promoting the 112 and the 100 components. And this is how the random texture would behave. Random texture would just lengthen, but specific other textures can shorten in the same material. This is entirely a texture effect. Also, this is a cube texture in aluminium, which was obtained by rolling and heat treatment. And it was a plate, but Rose and Stüwe, they were making cubes and then twisting them, and then they measured the length changes. Either was lengthening or was shortening, depending how they cut out the plate from the sample from the plate and how they made it a tube. So texture effect again, which could be reproduced quite precisely. In this case, the simulation was done by hand analytically because the texture was so simple. There are also stress effects. I go back here. Oh no, this is the stress. Now this is the stress here. This is the strain, this is the stress, yeah. If you keep the length of the sample constant, you don't lengthen, let it shorten or lengthen during torsion, then axial forces will appear. So these are usually compressive, this is the compression side, compressive, and then they change and they can be even tensile in certain cases. This is quite difficult to simulate because then you really have to simulate the whole bar torsion. And the bar torsion requires to examine the equilibrium equation within the bar. This equation has to be solved for the stress distribution. And then one can obtain what will be the total stress on the sample. Here are some simulations which show what is the difference between the simple shear axial stresses and the bar torsion axial stresses. They are quite in good agreement with the previous measurements. So, and finally, there was some even inverse shift effect, but I think I skip this one. This is so special. So we will look into how dynamic relaxation can be taken into account and modeled. Dynamic relaxation is frequently happening because if the testing is done at relatively higher temperatures, then it is always there. And together with the deformation process, it is affecting the texture evolution. So dynamic relaxation is always related to deformation. During deformation, a recrystallization process which is parallel. Otherwise, if it is it is called a static recrystallization. The dynamic means actually during deformation. DRX can be non-continuous or continuous. So non-continuous dynamic relaxation is happening when there is a nucleation of new grains and they grow and they just consume the other grains. So that requires new nuclei. It's happening mostly in materials which have low stacking forward energy. For materials which have higher stacking forward energy, then there can be also dynamic relaxation, but it is called continuous dynamic relaxation. These are the terms were introduced by Montelli in 1999 to distinguish the two processes. In the continuous one, there are no nucleus, no nuclei. They are not necessary. Actually, what is happening, the dislocations are are gathering and making walls, and subgrains appear, new subgrains during deformation, and they are rotating in a different manner a little bit as the mother grain, so they are contributing to the texture evolution. So this continuous dynamic realization is happening for materials which have high stacking fault energy. Continues. Grain fragmentation is mostly going on by continuous. But the non-continuous it also can happen for certain materials.
For high stacking fault energy.
Now, looking into the textures, what effects can be seen, identified. Here, one example is, this is copper deformed at different temperatures to the same, about the same very large strain. At room temperature, gamma 11, 125 degrees C, 200 degrees C, and 300 degrees C. So textures are shown these so-called final end textures at the end of the testing. We can see differences. Here there is a long fiber. Yeah. Also we can see that it's long fiber. Then here at 200 degrees C some components become stronger. And that here, really, we can see that a specific component, which is here, 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 is a so-called A component, single slip component of shear texture, which is going to be favored. It appears in different positions, at these positions here, here, and there. And then it becomes quite strong. This is part of the deformation texture. Actually, dynamic recrystallization is not going to produce really new components because deformation is going on, and whatever orientation change happens to the to a crystal, then finally it will follow the rotation field and will end up somewhere in a deformation texture component. So dynamic recrystallization usually is producing deformation texture, but with a different orientation density. Certain components become strong. Like here, in a simple shear of copper, the A component becomes specifically strong. So this texture, really, we can see that it's different from that one. When we think of what can influence the dynamic recrystallization process, we have to think of many modeling was based on the Taylor factor. The Taylor factor is simply, not yet defined that. When we in crystal plasticity, we calculate the slip distribution in a crystal. Then we can make the summation of all the slips together, their absolute values. And then we divide it with the imposed equivalent plastic strain. This is the so-called external strain which is imposed. This is the internal strain in terms of slip. And simply, this is the Taylor factor of a crystal. So this is calculated. This is known imposed on the crystal. The value varies from like about 2.2 to 5, between 2 and 5, approximately, the Taylor factor. So it's when it is low value, that means that there is not much slip. When it is a high value, then there's a lot of slip in the crystal. More slip is actually more stored energy because it produces more dislocations. And then the material, there is more energy. So that can be a driving force for moving grain boundaries. So what is happening in the polycrystal, that because of orientation differences, neighbor grains can have different Taylor factors. You know, like if let's say this grain has a high Taylor factor and the other one is a low Taylor factor, then a grain boundary between the two grains feels much more energy on one side than on the other side. Grain boundaries, especially during stress, so we apply here, let's say, shear stress, then grain boundaries under the stress, and on one side dislocation density is high, the other side it is low, the grain boundary will move. In which direction it is supposed to move? It is going to move in the direction to reduce the energy of the system. So it is going to move in that direction. So if there are neighbors with high dislocation density, they are going to be eliminated by the movement of the grain boundary for a grain which has a low stored energy. So low stored energy orientations which are suspected to be low Taylor factor grains, they can grow. They can grow during the deformation. You can simply, in the code what you use for the polycrystal plasticity, you have orientations and you make low Taylor factor orientations grow with a certain kinetics. What you decide, what you model. So this is one possibility, which is by the Taylor factor. Here there is a map of Taylor factor for the shear textures and ideal orientations. So again, here we see A, B, and C, and B bar, and A2 star. And the other part, the continuation is symmetric, because here only the Taylor factor is plotted. So we plot in orientation space the Taylor factor for simple shear. So it is like, you know, between two and it's up to four or five. The cube orientation has something like almost five as Taylor factor, and then the A orientation is something like two. So what is probable that a low Taylor factor orientation like A, if there is a neighbor next to it which is like a cube position, then its tendency is to eat that grain. So low Taylor factor positions will grow. And the lowest Taylor factor position in the shear texture is actually the A component. As I showed, finally, dynamic recrystallization leads to the strong A component, because this is the lowest Taylor factor orientation. So there is something to do, some business with the Taylor factor. Now, the other mechanism, well, so this is one mechanism, that low energy orientations grow faster than high energy orientations. There is also another mechanism, which of course depends on the stacking for the energy, you know, the the so-called, this can be also called as continuous. This can be considered as a continuous dynamic recrystallization process. The grain boundary is moving, but it requires strain. It requires stress applied on the grain boundary. The grain boundary is moving perpendicular to the applied stress. And there is no new nucleation of grain, so this is a continuous process, but with grain boundary motion. The other process is the so-called selective growth. Selective growth is different. Then we have to imagine that there's a grain, and if it has a neighbor has a specific orientation relationship with the mother grain, so-called CSL grain boundary. CSL means coincident site lattice. That's an integer number. So certain number of atoms from one side and from the other side, they are common here around the grain boundary in the two grains. So they are already in good positions. Like CSL of 11 is a specific in 38 degrees orientation difference between the two grains. It's a CSL position. And in that case, the grain boundary has a higher mobility because already every 11 atoms are already in position. And they don't change position during the motion of the grain boundary. So that's also a mechanism. And it can be also imagined if it is not a neighbor, but it's a nucleus, which appear, let's say, at a triple junction, a nucleus, a small nucleus, and it appears in CSL orientation with respect to the mother grain, then it will grow and consume this grain. So in that case, that orientation is converted into an orientation which is going to be related to it by rotation, a CSL rotation, 38 degrees, this is around 111 plane normal. It's happening in the FCC materials, CSL 11. This is a possible mechanism. So these two cannot be neglected and can be put into the modeling, together with the deformation. Deformation, we know already how to do. It's happening anyway, slips are calculated, grains rotate, and so on. But we put something more, like we will increase the volume of low energy orientations, and at the same time we decrease all the others, so that the total volume is constant. Or we make growth certain nucleus, which we create artificially, and let them grow and eat the mother grain. These two mechanisms can be implemented into modeling. Of course, then you have to be a user of, I don't know, which level, level 4, or at least level 3, so that you touch the code and you try to implement this into the code. It's not very simple. For example, here, this looks to be quite okay. Yeah, we have the orientations. We only change the volume fraction. We calculate the Taylor factors, and then we see if it is low, then I make it faster growing. It is high, then it's slow growing. And I look at the texture evolution. But this one, this selective growth mechanism, is more complex. Here, these nuclei can appear, many of them, because of symmetry of the crystal. So already you have to take all of them into account, or what to do? Do you apply a selective selection criterion? Which variant would finally eat the grain? So what we do is, of course, then we take all the variants, and we apply a variant selection theory. What is a variant selection theory? This is just an idea. Here, for example, for CSL equal to 11, 111 planes are the normal axis are the rotations, and one we applied with John Jonas in 1992, an idea that the most active slip system with its 111 plane would be favored, and that variant selection was made grow. So all this can be put into, but you have to have all the other variants. So here this is like the twinning simulation. There are these possible daughter grains which will finally grow, and then consume the mother grain. Little bit similar. The simulation code is a little bit complex. But the same kind of technique, which I explained for twinning, can be applied in that case too. Let's see some kind of results. That simulation was done for a large train of simple shear. Again, we are still in the copper. So this was the 300 degrees C testing, which led to a strong A component. The A component, now the whole texture is shown. I mean, not the whole, but four sections of the ODF are shown here. Measurement and simulated is on the right side. The A component, which is very strong, is here. Here and also here, appears again here. One can see this is really a strong component, but others are also strong, like the C, relatively, and B component. They are also appreciably strong. Here, the simulation was done up to the shear strain of 4, and then both mechanisms, this oriented nucleation and growth, and the selective growth were modeled. This is the result obtained in terms of recrystallization volume fraction of the new grains. It goes up to volume fraction of 6, exceeding the volume fraction of 1. Because it is recrystallizing several times. So not only 1, but up to 6. So the oriented nucleation was done according to this mechanism, and the selective growth was done by this mechanism, applying selective growth criterion only for those slip systems which had carried the most deformation in them. So they were rotated by 38 degrees around the 111 plane and then made grow faster and more and more, and at the same time the mother grain orientation was reduced with the same value. But we have found that there was an incubation strain which was needed that recrystallization initiates. It's usually the case in dynamic recrystallization that energy has to accumulate in the grains, so there is a strain which is usually not small, depending on temperature. Here it's only 300 degrees C, so this is not really a recrystallization temperature of copper, that's more 450. But if you add to the temperature 300 degrees C, you add the energy, strain energy, which is accumulating by strain hardening in the material, then actually grain boundary motion and recrystallization is initiated. This appears, for example, in the stress strain curves in this manner. The stress strain curve is showing a maximum. When a large strain, let's say, something like 4. And when this maximum is reached, then there is softening. This softening is a sign, it's an absolute certain sign for dynamic recrystallization is happening. But there is a certain strain needed to reach that. So here it was about 1.5 shear strain, but we let the material waiting, accumulating the energy, and then the processes was implemented. Oriented nucleation produced this volume. So it mostly was, you know, the low energy orientations. In shear textures, almost all orientations are low energy because only single slip or double slip in the ideal positions. And all these positions here actually ideal. There is a fiber here which is crossing like that. Other fiber is here. So they are all growing, and other orientations which are not in ideal positions, like the cube, rotated cube, is decreasing in volume. And finally, we can see that the selective growth, of course, it was tuned. You know, you have a parameter for the speed of oriented nucleation, you have parameter for the rate of selective growth and making new orientations. And then you play until you say that the measured texture is the nearest to the simulated one. And indeed, if you look at the comparison between these two ODFs, it is strikingly good. It is so good that it would be difficult to imagine better simulation result. I have to tell you, I was doing the simulation, and then I was playing quite long time until the right parameters for these recrystallization mechanisms were obtained. And also, we found by the simulation that selection criterion had to be applied for the selective growth, which was much less important. But you see, it's about 3 times smaller in contribution to the recrystallization, but it must be there. It produces some effects in the texture. And it was only effective if we applied a specific selection criterion for the 4 possible variants. There is only 4 in 4 daughter grains in FCC case. And then in this way, we identified which mechanism was the most important. It happened to be the, now this is the oriented nucleation, yeah. This is the selective growth. And that's the total, the sum of these two for the volume fraction, new volume fraction made. You see that the oriented nucleation is more than twice more than the selective growth. Both of them are important mechanisms. So playing with the parameters, and until we get a beautiful agreement in textures, and then we can say that our simulation has some kind of physical meaning. It is really happening probably in this way. Especially one had to reproduce this kind of fiber here, which is made by dynamic recrystallization. Another application I show you also, this was simulation of dynamic recrystallization in IF steel, interstitial free steel. This is BCC. So the ideal orientations are different. Strain here was very large. Equivalent strain of 19, which is more than shear strain of 30. The experiment was on a little bit higher temperature. And again, using the same mechanisms which are presented here, so oriented nucleation and growth, but here selective growth was not relevant, only the oriented nucleation and growth. You can appreciate the agreement between the measured texture and the simulated texture up to this extremely large strain. Luckily here, well, self-consistent model was already available, that was used, and the effect of dynamic recrystallization is also that the shape effect of the grains is somehow disappearing, because we know in self-consistent modeling the shape is very important. But dynamic recrystallization has an effect on grain shape. So shear deformation would change a spherical grain into an elongated grain. Yeah? This is the effect of shear. But once it is elongated and recrystallization is happening, the neighbor grains go in and out in these grain boundaries, and then finally the grain structure becomes more spherical, with a little bit of elongation perhaps. Effect of DRX on grain shape. It's enormous. Instead of finding elongated grains, dynamic flexization is producing spherical, globular grain shapes. And then we just, in the self-consistent model, actually we use spherical shape all the time. And then we can go to very large strain, like this is huge amount of strain, can be simulated. But the simulation was done at an initial stage. We let the grain shape evolve, and then when dynamic flexization begins, then we imposed the spherical shape all along after. And this is how this beautiful agreement with the experiment could be obtained. Here the eye orientations are different. That's D2, D1, F orientations, and J1, J2, F1, F2 are identified because it's BCC, not FCC crystal texture. We also identified the existence of a new component, what we called T. This is somehow made by the effect of dynamic recrystallization, an orientation which belongs actually to the effect of dynamic recrystallization, and quite strong. We called it T component. So you see, this is an interesting example that how many things can be done by polycrystal plasticity. You can do a whole metallurgy. We did what? We did an example, so there is, you know, deformation texture evolution, simply. Then we did twinning. Now we did dynamic recrystallization, strain hardening. So what else? Phase transformations, of course. That is also possible. You can have even two different phases at the same time present in your simulation. The Los Alamos self-consistent code is constructed in such a way that you have the possibility to define two phases, or even more, as many as you want. And then look at the evolution of the texture for both phases. That is possible to do with the Los Alamos code. So you can do practically all metallurgy with polycrystal plasticity. So I hope that you will enjoy, and then you will also develop some features which are not yet done with crystal plasticity. We will start tomorrow this process. Some of you already is actually masters of VPSC calculations. I got already a paper in which I can enjoy your expertise. But many of you, of course, I think is in terms of polycrystal plasticity texture simulation is beginner. But you will see how fast you can become an expert. So this is the objective of the course, to get into that expertise and then produce very nice simulations and then publish all these. I will be happy to see your papers as a reviewer in the future. So that's what we do tomorrow from 10 o'clock in the morning. Not 9, 10 o'clock we begin tomorrow. Bring your laptop, and then we will install the softwares needed and then try to do some simulation work. Okay? Thank you.